Thank you for taking the time, Mike. Aside from having to talk to this guy, how's your day going so far?
Good. I actually work with the great Wayne Kramer. I don't know if you know who that is, but
I've had the pleasure of interviewing Brother Wayne. Hell of an author. Cool. Beyond the changing the world as a musician and a poet, etc.
Yeah, I'm at his studio right now, and we do he does a nonprofit called Jail Guitar Doors. And mm-hmm. I don't know how deep of a dive you did on me, but I did get in trouble due to a business I ran for a long time and did 2 years in a federal camp. And mm-hmm. Brother Wayne did 2 years in a camp in the 70s. And so we connected on that level. And I'm working now at the studio where we're trying to teach music and the music business to at-risk youth and formerly incarcerated people.
Fantastic cause, to say the least. And it shows that second chances can lead to greater things. But on the positive, awesome end, the Ataris are back. Big shows coming up at the Wiltern. Is this the Ataris are here to stay, or is it let's do these two shows and see where it goes?
Well, it's these are the two reunion shows for our 20-year anniversary of our biggest record, and we're working on some more stuff for the future. But for this year, that's it for this year. For 2024, we expect there to be more on the horizon. And we're working on some stuff that I don't want to give away just yet right here. But right. It's exciting. But right now, you know, I'm finishing up. I'm working on my psychology degree, my bachelor's degree at Cal State Northridge. And so I'm tied down here in LA until I finish that. It's something that when COVID hit, I decided to go back to school and finish mm-hmm. what I started before the Ataris. And I'm really close. So it all coincides probably with that. When that's finished, which I'll graduate May of 2024, then we'll probably see much more Atari stuff then.
Fantastic. These shows not just have the Ataris playing the great, great album, but you have a reunion of Samiam on there. You're getting, say, Ferris back together. Or as far as I know, that lineup of, say, Ferris had not been doing a lot of gigs. Did you book the shows and then beg the friends to get back together? Or how did that all work out?
Well, all of us had a little play in there. I'm good friends with Justin, the guitar player for Save Ferris. So we wanted, and Chris is very good. Well, we're all friends with Serge from Samiam, but Chris is my singer, Chris Rowe, is responsible for Samiam. And so I got to give him credit for that, because that's crazy getting them to play that show. And then Save Ferris was me. I reached out to Justin because I was trying to think of a great main support band that's similar, you know. We're not touring right now, and neither is Save Ferris. And you have to think of a band, a lot of bands, they want tours, right? And so they're holding out for a tour. So you have to think of a band that would not only go good with you, but draw from a different crowd. And also, I like them, you know. Save Ferris, the Ataris, and the Vandals had a great show at Angel Stadium many years ago. And so it was kind of a, you know, all of that melded together. We hadn't played with them since then, I don't think. It'd been like 20 years since we played with Save Ferris. So I think all of that worked out well. And Samiam haven't played in LA in 20 years. So, you know, it's going to be really great. And then over on our House of Blues Anaheim show, we actually have Paulin is a band that hasn't played a show in 20 years. And they're an amazing band as well. So we have a lot of that going on.
In the case of Save Ferris, you also have a lot in common in that you're both bands that have an 80s themed band name, and you both had a big hit that was a cover that, even though the other material was better, those were the gateway for a lot of people to find your band.
Yeah, I didn't want to say the elephant in the room, but definitely K-Rock loves here in LA. K-Rock LA really loves the two one hit cover band wonders for them as far as radio goes. But you're right, we have a great career as indie bands, both of us.
Well, enough time has passed, and I mean this as a compliment, that the Ataris are now a classic rock band. And I say that because in the late 90s, early 2000s, when Poison decided to come back and do the Amphitheater Shed tour, and you saw that it was Poison, LA Guns, Rat, Quiet Riot, that kind of thing, you'd go, yeah, I guess they can fill out these amphitheaters. And now at this point in time, if you say, well, the Ataris, Sugar Cult, MXPX, you could be playing to 12,000 people a night at sheds.
Yeah, it's really strange to me that the comeback, right, of pop punk. And the one thing I keep seeing is that pop punk is now dad rock, right? And so, and that's really cool, because I got to say, 10 years ago when we were playing, it was like tough. It was 10 years after our hit, and it was a little tough. And all of a sudden, with COVID hits, and then pop punk is now like cool again, right? And yeah. when we were young, Festival has really helped with that. And Blink 182's reunion and Green Day just keeps marching on. But I was looking at the K-Rock Top 20 the other day here in LA, and it's like 12 or 13 of them are pop punk bands, and most of them are from my area. There's a couple of the new ones, the Mod Sun and stuff like that, but most of them are from my era. And I really think that's super cool. So we are working on new music, and so we're hoping, you know, that we're not just going to be known for our old songs, but you know, our old songs are great, as you say.
Hey, I do mean those compliments. I did grow up as an Ataris fan first from, you know, the compilations of Kung Fu Records, Beyond the Studio Records. The whole Punkorama world was basically an introductory thing to all these underground bands. And then of course you got on MTV2 and you were everywhere. So you did the underground thing, you did the mainstream thing, and you thrived in both ways. But you make a very interesting point where you say, you know, 10 years or so ago, it was kind of tough, where that after you're on the major label period. And that's something that came up, a weird name check, but I was interviewing the singer of the band 9 Days last week. And Story of a Girl was this huge hit. And then Nobody Wants to Know You. And then now in the last year and a half, that's been used in 2 or 3 big movies and TV shows. It's a new interpolated cover for this artist on Elektra. So everything old is new again in a way. And when did you start to notice of, hey, the music that we did that was, quote, outdated 10 years ago is now what everyone loves?
Well, I really believe it happened during COVID, and maybe a little bit of it has to do with this TikTok world, right? Mm-hmm. I have a 12-year-old and a 16-year-old, and they both are TikTok crazy, right? Girls. And yeah. they are like, the other day I go, what are you listening to? Oh, we're watching TikTok. I'm all, is that Pavement? And they're like, they look up the song and it was Pavement. They're like, oh, this song's everywhere. I'm all, who knew Pavement would be so cool on TikTok like 30 years later? It blows my mind. Then they started showing me all the Ataris things on TikTok of people speeding up the songs and doing all the other stuff. And I really think TikTok helps with that. And I really think it also is that maybe during that 10 year, most of the people that were big fans of ours were like struggling to find their own identity as adults, right? They're, yeah. you're 17, 18, 19, 20 and loving the Ataris and Boys of Summer's number one and all that. And then all of a sudden, you know, you're in your mid 20s and trying to build your own family and things like that. Well, now they all seem to be set, right? And they all have their own careers. And I know that because I have a lot of friends that were also fans, you know, and now they're all like able to put the kids with the nanny or whatever and come out to the punk show. So
it's always great when you have that young fan base that grows up and now has jobs so they can pay for the VIP packages and the merch and all that.
That part's crazy to me too. I looked at tickets at the Wiltern just for kicks because we got the links. And then I started seeing this VIP club add-on and stuff. And the same for House of Blues. I had a buddy email me, oh, I bought the VIP tickets. He texted me and I'm like, oh, what? So those were things that were never for sale, you know, 20 years ago when we were selling right. out. Even 10 years ago, we did the reunion tour. We did the 10-year reunion, which was very successful as well. And we sold out both the Anaheim and the old Hollywood House of Blues, which no longer exists. But But on those tours, there was no VIP upgrade and stuff. So that's a new twist that's coming along too. So it's pretty interesting to me. I need to go take a trip because I'm the guy that's going to go straight into the crowd, right? And see all my friends and everything. So I need to take a trip and see what the VIP room's all about. I'll let you know.
Yeah. The dynamic of that, I think that all started, and I give credit to Josh Fries for this. Do you remember Josh Fries's solo album where he did the campaign where it was like $2,000 and you go to PF Chang's with me and Maynard?
Yeah. I remember that.
Josh Fries accidentally created the VIP package.
He did, or the meet and greet, right? I mean, as we know it. And I love Josh. We toured all over the world together because the Vandals discovered us, right? And so Josh was a big part of my growing up on tour, and he's so cool, right? He just knows, he's ahead of his time. So, you know, that's my dark horse pick for the next Guns N' Roses drummer. And I don't know anything. I have one little tidbit. I saw Dave Grohl at his 50th birthday party. So I could be way off base and don't know anything. But when I saw that, I was like, maybe, right? So next drummer for the Foo Fighters.
You know, I my money was on Travis Barker going, I need a fourth job. And doing that. That's what I thought it was going to be. That it was going to be, depending on the show, it's going to be either Travis Barker or Taylor's son and Nandi. I think those were the three ones that but I think you hit the nail on the head. And
I think, Travis, Courtney won't let him do a fourth band. I think that Taylor's son is too young still, and they don't want to expose him to that. And, but you might be right about Nandi, but I don't know. I have no inside information. This is just from me seeing Dave at Josh's birthday party. So we'll see. You can hit me up and see if I'm right. How's that?
If Josh gets that gig, what gig has to go away? Is it Sting? Is it Nine Inch Nails, Paul Westerberg, Weezer, the Phantom?
It's all of it. If you take that gig, that's your gig. Except the Vandals. He'll always play in the Vandals when he can. That's the deal.
Exactly. Well, hey, back to you. It sounds like what we were talking at the beginning, that things have turned around for you in a fantastic way, that music is the focal point, that there's family going on, working with Wayne Kramer, etc. What's the last album of yours that we should be checking out before we get into the latest and the greatest from what might come from the Ataris?
Well, I mean, my last Versus the World record came out. That's the band that I did when I left the Ataris in 2006. I left the Ataris and I formed Versus the World with my best friend, Donald Spence. And we did three albums and they're all great. But I still to this day say Homesick, Roadsick, which came out in 2016, it is on par with So Long Astoria. Those two are my most proud moments as a musician. So I would say if you're looking at both of my bands, that those two records are my proud moments.
Cool. My last question for you before I let you go, and this could yield a no answer or could actually yield an anecdote. But what I want to know is every time I've interviewed a member of the Eagles, I have had a condescending, awful experience.
Right.
In your case, did you have any positive interactions with Don Henley?
Well, I don't know if you ever watched Joel's podcast, but I have an amazing Don Henley story, and it's a long story, but I'll try to do it quickly. It'll be in my book for sure. I wrote this 33-page. Yeah, it's coming. Wrote this 33-page short story that's going to be included in the book about how Boys of Summer came to be. But the crescendo of that was that we had to play the MLB All-Star game. We played Boys of Summer on second base in 2003 at Cellular Field in Chicago. To do that, we had to get permission from Don Henley. You don't have to get permission to play it anywhere except on live TV. And so Don wasn't happy that Chris had wore a shirt at the K-Rock Weenie Roast that said, "Who the fuck is Don Henley?" And then And then Rolling Stone posted a picture of that shirt of us all together and Chris with the shirt with blood. He did the kiss blood running down his face. So what happened then is that Don saw that picture and interpreted it wrong. Chris wore that shirt, made that shirt because he was kind of upset that fans didn't know us from our earlier work, that they only thought that we were Boys of Summer. And most of our fans didn't even know that was a cover. Right. So Chris kind of did that as an homage, but Don took it wrong. So I had to call Don. I got his phone number by illicit means from my manager who acquired it from illicit means. And I left him a message, this heartfelt message after we did the Jimmy Kimmel show. I had to get up my nerve. It took me like 3 or 4 days and I called him up and I left this message, which is all true. The Eagles were one of my favorite bands. My dad, we played one of Don's songs at my dad's funeral. My dad died tragically in a car accident when I was 19. Mm-hmm. I told Don all of that with almost tears coming out. And a couple days later, Don called me back. And he said these words right off the bat. He was a poet. It was like poetic. He said, I'll always remember this. He said, I know what it's like to be young and climbing the ladder of rock and roll and everything's a big deal. Those were his first words. I don't remember after that, I blacked out, right? But those were his first words to me. And then he went on to explain. I told him about Chris and he told me that it was okay for us to play the song at the All-Star game. So, you know, Don Henley was amazing to me. Then I pitched him to play with us on MTV Music Awards, but he down, but I had to shoot for the stars, right? So
yeah, if you look at the stuff that he's done over the years, there was that Axl Rose performance there. What was another cool Don Henley moment? I mean, he brought the world Sheryl Crow,
right?
I'm blanking on the good stuff he's done. He's done great stuff that's been under the radar, and he's not out to dispel the myth that he's tough to deal with.
It wouldn't have been tough for him to go on the MTV Music Awards with the Ataris, but that was in vogue at the time. Yeah. The cover song and then getting the artist to come out and play with you. And I tried hard after I warmed up to him and we spoke for like about 20 minutes and he was really nice to me. Now, everybody else, and he talks a lot of smack out there about our version of Boys of Summer. He does. Chris Rose showed me that. But for some reason to me, and I think it might have been my heartfelt message, he connected with me. I had to call him back one more time to let him, for us to play Boys of Summer in Canada at a live TV event. And he, again, gave us permission to do it. So to this day, my band and my management and everybody says that if it wasn't for that phone call, we would have been fucked. How's that? So
you got the permission and Letterman didn't. So I think that speaks volumes.
Yes.
So Mike, thank you for your time. Looking forward to more activity from you as a side performer with the Ataris, etc. And glad to see you're back in action.
All right. Thanks, Darren. Have a good one.
Thanks. Paltrocast.